Good morning.
Good morning.
I put my cell phone on a clock, and I'll put it on the podium. Do you know what it means when a pastor puts his watch or clock on the podium?
Nothing.
In fact, it just stopped working, so forget you. I got my watch on. But it is a real privilege to be here with you today. It's a sacred trust. I have some big shoes to fill. Brother Lee is an excellent Bible teacher, and he was one of the things that attracted us to the ministry here. And of course, Brother Tom. There's just so many really good things that are happening in this ministry. There's a team effort here. The folks that run the sound and the website are second to none, and the musicians are second to none, and yet they're all humble, and they have a desire to know the Lord. The elders, the three elders, are servants who have a real desire to lead you in the paths of righteousness and to know Christ. And so it's just an awesome place to come, an amazing place to come. Would you take your Bibles and turn to the book of Nehemiah this morning? Nehemiah chapter 1. If you're looking for Nehemiah, it's about halfway through your Bible. There's 2 Kings, and then there's Ezra, and then there's Nehemiah, there's Esther, and then there's Job, and then there's the Psalms. So if you get to the Psalms, you've gone too far. If you're still in 1 and 2 Kings, go to the right. Nehemiah. Nehemiah is one of my favorite men in the Bible because he's a humble servant. And we're going to look into just the first chapter today and look at some things I believe will be helpful to us. Nehemiah chapter 1, if we were to give it a title, we would entitle it Faith in God and Courage During Difficult Times. Now, I'm going to share some things with you that God's showing me from my life. I didn't prepare this message for you. God prepared my time in the Word for me. And then as I was studying this over the last several weeks, God said, I want you to share that someday if you're asked to fill the pulpit. And so it was just a God thing. Hebrews 11:6 says, but without faith it is impossible to please God. For he that comes to God must believe that he is. You know, God is real. God is genuine. He is there. He's always been there, and he'll always be there. So by faith, we believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them. He wants to bless those who, what, diligently seek him. And so we're reminded of those things. Here's a family picture. It's just a couple years old. One of our adult daughters was not available for the picture. We have 9 children, 4 boys and 5 girls. We thought at number 6 we would stop. We had 4 boys and 2 girls. And then God led us into foster parenting. And we had the privilege of having a foster daughter who eventually moved out, went to college, and got married. And she loves the Lord. And her family are involved in a church this morning in Pennsylvania. And then we adopted 2 more children that were foster children of our own. And we're grateful. We're blessed. We have 15 grandchildren as of today, and holding at that number for a while. And so we're just very, very thankful. My wife, Crystal, is an equal partner in our marriage, in my ministry over the years in different churches. And, you know, without a godly wife, a godly man doesn't go very far. God put us together. And I often say that I have 9 children and my wife has 10, including me. She tells me sometime I need to grow up. I love to be a tease, and that's just part of life. But Crystal, at the age of 8, in a Baptist church down in Pennsylvania, walked up to the front to respond to the invitation to receive Christ as her personal Savior. And so at the age of 8, having grown up in a Christian home, she understood that Christ loved her. He died on the cross. He was buried. He rose again. And he offers forgiveness to everyone who puts their faith in him, who believes in him, who puts their trust in him. At the age of 16 or 17, somewhere around 17, I was invited to a Bible study in Boynton Beach, Florida. That's where I come from, South Florida. And it was a Bible study called Ranch. It was a bunch of teenagers, and I wasn't interested in the Bible, but they were having a lot of fun, so I went to have some fun with them. But every night there was a serious time of sharing the Word of God, and the youth leader there shared the scriptures with us time and again. And finally, one night, it finally dawned on me. I finally understood. I had that aha moment. Oh, that's what it's all about. I understood for the first time in my life. Though I was religious before that, I didn't have a relationship with Christ. See, you can be religious and have rituals, but have no relationship with God. And a lot of us are that way. In fact, all of us are that way before we come to Christ, right? And it was that moment, that night, when the brother was sitting up on a steamer trunk, Jim Minker, who's now gone on holding with the Lord, he sat on that trunk and he said, as I'm putting my trust in this big old trunk to hold me up, you need to put your trust in Christ as the one who died on the cross to pay for all of your sins so you can be completely forgiven. All your past, present, and future sins are covered in the blood of Christ, but you've got to trust in him. And I thought, wow, that makes sense. I'd always believed historically in Jesus Christ. I was a good Roman Catholic person. I had always believed that Christ was a Savior. He wasn't my Savior, but he was a Savior. It was that night that my eyes were open. I said, I need to put my faith, my trust in Christ as my sin bearer. And by the grace of God, by his calling me and encouraging me and enabling me, I put my trust in the Lord and I was saved. And shortly thereafter, I was started attending Lake Worth Bible Church. That was my home church. My pastor's still alive. He's about 143 now. And I just called him a few weeks ago. His name's Norm Spire. And Norm and Sandy, they're both, I think, in their 90s. They are very close to it and still serving the Lord as an associate pastor. So, Brother Tom, you've got a whole lot more years to keep going to catch up with Brother Norm. But praise the Lord. Lake Worth Bible Church is where I learned to grow. I then went off to Florida Bible College. I thought I was just going to get an education on how to live for Christ, but God had plans to put my wife and I in the ministry, and we've been humbled by that ever since then, that day. And I was baptized at Florida Bible Church upon profession of my faith in Christ years before. Well, that's just a little bit about ourselves. 2 years ago, we bought a house here in Clarkson, up on the ridge, and God led us to retire to this area. And we've been looking for a church family just to be a part of, and God led us to this church family, and we are so privileged to be here. Just an amazing congregation, amazing people. It's almost hard to preach after Brother Dave and the music team ministers to us because I get all teary-eyed singing those songs. They're so real, they're so genuine, they're so relevant to where we live. And what a joy last night for me to call or to send a text to Tim and Courtney Peterson and said, could you insert a video in my PowerPoint tomorrow? Would that be okay? And they said, no problem. And to be able to work with a team of people highly committed to Christ. And so praise the Lord for what he is doing. Now my focus, whenever I teach, I try to ask myself this question. I learned this from a fellow that was a seminary professor in Dallas. And he always asked himself, what on earth am I about to do to these folks? That's a good question every teacher, pastor, preacher ought to ask, because we're not just here to fill heads with information. Our time together in the Word of God should result in you and I both knowing God better and mostly in loving Him more. See, I've learned that I can study the Word of God but not love God. Now, that's the unnatural progression. The natural is you study the Word of God, and we need to know the Word of God. It is the living Word. It is inerrant. It is infallible. It is all-sufficient. It is God's revealed and preserved Word for you and I today. But we need to know it. But if we just know it and we don't apply it, if we don't say, Lord, what is there in this text that you wanted me to see for my life today? If we don't do that, we won't love God more. And so it's both. Process. I always ask myself, is my message practical? By the way, having 9 children was helpful. You know, sometimes during lunch we'd have roast pastor. I mean, not terribly roasted, but my kids might say, you know, Dad, you didn't quite hit the nail on the head today. Or, what did you mean by that comment? We were all wondering. Sometimes I would say things from the pulpit and my daughter Sarah would just speak up right from the area. One time I said something about, I want you to remember these 5 words, and I mentioned 6 words, and she said, Father dear, that was 6, not 5. So she's an extrovert. And today she's been a foster mom, and she's a nurse, and we praise the Lord for her. So the context of Nehemiah is very important. The context of any passage is important. I hope that you and I do not fall into the wrongful pattern of just reading a verse or hearing a verse and not asking ourselves, what does it really mean? By the way, anything I may ever teach you today or any time in the future or any other person teaching you, you need to see it for yourselves in the Word of God. So you either have a copy open on your phone or a paper copy, whatever, because if you can't see it for yourself and in the context, I could easily mislead you. And so can anybody else on the radio, the television, when they write a book. So context, we often say, is king. For example, there was a fellow who was told one day, he said, well, they said, how do you have your devotions? He says, oh, it's real simple. I flip open the Bible, I put my finger down, or wherever it lands, that's for me. So one day he did that, and it said, and Judas went out and hung himself. And he said, whoa, that's not good. So he flipped over, and he, boom, and it says, go thou and do likewise. Well, that's a joke, but, you know, the truth is, you need to know the context. Remember this, not every scripture was written to us, but every scripture was written for us. The Old Testament sacrifices were written for us, not to us, right? So always ask yourself, is this written to me or is this for me? And there's a difference. Well, Nehemiah was a Jew living in exile. He was in the kingdom of Persia under King Artaxerxes, and he served as a royal cupbearer. I said, think Secret Service agent. He was the guy that they would bring the food to and they'd say, Nehemiah, taste this and eat this, and if you don't drop dead in an hour, we'll give it to the king. You know? And so if you want to get to the king, you got rid of the royal cupbearer. So he's a very trusted person. He had a great job. He was well cared for. He had no concerns. He was born in exile. It was the only life he ever knew. He could have just kept his mouth shut and not be concerned about Jerusalem, and he would have gone on and lived a very full life and had all of his needs taken care of. But he didn't. The year was around 444 B.C. Little time, well, let's see, Tom. No, you weren't back there. But no, you don't. You're a young guy. But the truth of the matter is that was a while back, but about 170 years before that time, the Jews had been gone into captivity. Remember Jeremiah, Book of Lamentations? They had continued to sin against God, long time, disobedience, and God finally said, enough, you're going into captivity. So for 70 years, the Babylonians put them in captivity and emptied Jerusalem. What did the Babylonians do to Jerusalem when they attacked the city? Do you remember? They tore it down. They just, not one stone remained upon another. And they took all the people out of there and just left a straggler, a handful of people to remain. Well, after the 70 years, God sent Zerubbabel to go into the land, back to Jerusalem. He sent with him about 42,000 Jews to assist. And they were going to rebuild the temple, and they did. And so that was around 537 B.C. So this is well before Nehemiah's time. Captivity of Jerusalem, Zerubbabel rebuilds the temple. 100 years later, Nehemiah chapter 1 takes place. You ever get the impression that God's not in a hurry? But God's going to accomplish his work, isn't he? God has his timetable and I have mine. And I sometimes argue with God why he's not doing it according to my timetable. And God says, so who's God here, you or me? And we're mindful that it's God who is God. Well, during this 100 years, the city of Jerusalem continues to lay in waste. The people are under reproach. So about 20 years before Nehemiah chapter 1 takes place, Ezra, sent by God to go back to Jerusalem. The temple's been built already. It's been there for 80 years. The city lies in ruins. Ezra had a passion to teach the Word of God. He knew that it was the Word of God that would bring revitalization to the people of Israel. And so he goes back, and he's teaching away, but still, the city's in ruins. Nobody's doing anything. The people are in reproach. And so we're going to come to chapter 1 in just a moment, but just a note. The books of Ezra and Nehemiah, if you read a Hebrew study Bible or Hebrew Bible of the Old Testament, they're just one book. We have two in the English version, but it's just one book, and it talks about the whole story from Zerubbabel to Ezra to Nehemiah. And also, just to kind of give you a reference, this is also the same time of Esther. The book of Esther was written as well. Now, that's kind of a backdrop. So let's read Nehemiah chapter 1. Just follow along if you would, please. The words of Nehemiah, the son of Hakaliah. It came to pass in the month of Chislev, in the 20th year, as I was in Shushan, the citadel, so around 444 B.C., then Hananiah, one of my brethren, came with men from Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews who had escaped, who had survived the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem. And they said to me, "The survivors who are left from captivity in the province are there in great distress and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem is also broken down, and its gates are burned with fire." How does Nehemiah respond? "So it was when I heard these words that I sat down and I wept and I mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven. And I said, I pray, Lord God of heaven, O great and awesome God, you who keep your covenant and mercy with those who you love, who love you and observe your commandments, please let your ear be attentive and your eyes open that you may hear the prayer of your servant, which I pray before you now day and night for the children of Israel, your servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we have sinned against you. Both my father's house and I have sinned. We have acted very corruptly against you and have not kept the commandments, the statutes, nor the ordinances which you commanded your servant Moses. Remember, I pray, that you commanded your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. Now, verse 9 says this, but if you return to me and keep my commandments and do them, though some of you were cast out to the furthest part of the heavens, yet I will gather them from there and bring them to the place which I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. That place, of course, was Jerusalem, the city of God. Verse 10, now these are your servants and your people whom you have redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand. O Lord, I pray, please let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who desire to fear your name. And let your servant prosper this day, I pray, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. As you see on the screen here, just want to have some interaction with you. By the way, you're allowed to respond. You can say praise the Lord, amen. You can even raise your hand if you have a question. I won't call upon a lot of folks because I want to get through the message. But I do like interaction with people. So what do you see taking place in this text? What's going on? Now, I won't call upon you because I don't want to put anybody on the spot. But if your name starts with T, I'll start with you. No, I'm just kidding. Thaddeus is T. What do you see in this text? What's going on? You say, this is different. You want me to think about what you're saying as you preach, and you want me to interact with you. I know it's different, but it's okay. It's good. What's going on in this text? What do you see? How would you summarize it? If you had a 5-year-old kindergarten kid come to you and say, I just read Nehemiah chapter 1. In a nutshell, what's it about? There's great distress in the land. There's a reproach that's overcome. It's been there for 170 years. It's known by all. Discouragement. Things are broken down and the people are under reproach. They have no identity. They have no safety. They have no security. They have no hope. They've lost hope. How else would you summarize this text? Don't be shy. Yes.
In the midst of feeling hopeless, he worships the Lord in the way he turns to him.
Oh, that's so good, Alice. In the midst of this hopelessness, Nehemiah prays and worships God. He saw the problem, but he didn't put his eyes on the problem. That's my problem. That's your problem. We look at the problem. Nehemiah looked to the God who was awesome and amazing. As Dave led us today in some songs along with the worship team, those songs remind us how great our God is and how mighty and how you can trust Him and He can do above and beyond anything we can imagine. What else did you kind of pick up on in that text?
Acknowledgement of sin.
Yeah, that really caught my eye. Acknowledgement of sin. It wasn't just the sins of the people, right?
And the people.
Right. My father sinned, and that's why we went in captivity. But God, I have been sinning against you. Let us never forget that though we are cleansed by the blood of Christ, we daily must confess sins as they come up. We daily must deal with a sinful nature that remains. That sinful nature within us does not have authority over us, but it sure tries to influence us. And every morning I wake up and look in the mirror, I say, "Good morning, Mr. Sinner, how are you today?" You know, when you remind yourself that you are a sinner like everyone else, though you may be walking in obedience today, it's so easy to go into sin tomorrow. And there's a lot of things that are sinful that we don't want to admit, such as being self-centered, not thinking of others as highly as we should, not giving God all the glory for what He's done in our lives. You know, so often we take the credit for what we've done. In reality, is there anything we can do unless God enabled us? Where do we get our breath from? Where do we get our living spirit? Where do we get the world we live in? Where do we get the jobs and the skills and the abilities to earn and the things to have? Where do children come from? Everything comes from God. And who owns it all? God does. And so we're foolish to think, look at what I've done. No, look at what God has done. Daniel was willing to say, "Hey, I've sinned against you as well. And because of that, there's been consequences." What else do you see in this chapter?
Hope.
There's hope. In the darkest hours, when a country has two presidents. Our hope is in the Lord. Our confidence is in the Lord. Christians who are intimately abiding in Christ, who are following the Lord, who love God more than anything else, they're not fazed by politicians, they're not fazed by the economy, they're not fazed by their health, because God is our hope, and we have confidence that if, in fact, the exit plan is pretty good for believers. When the Lord said it's time to come home, He graduates us, we leave our body, we go to be with the Lord. "Oh, thus shall we ever be with the Lord." Praise the Lord. That's a graduation day. Now, I'm not ready to graduate. If the Lord wants me to, then I'm ready. But I'm thankful. There's a lot of things that we see. Who is the primary character in this text? Is it Nehemiah? What do you think, Tom? Is it Nehemiah? Now, someone said, it's God. The focus of the book of Nehemiah is God. Not look at what Nehemiah does, it's look what God does. Let us never forget that. It's not about what the pastor, the elders do, a church does. It's what does God do in our lives? He's an amazing God. Verses 1 through 3, we've already talked about it. What's the condition of Jerusalem, the city of God? It lays in ruins. There is great reproach. What was Nehemiah's response to the devastation of Jerusalem? Verse 4, "So it was when I heard these words that I sat down and I wept and I mourned for many days. I was fasting and praying before the God of heaven." Someday I'll have the privilege to do a series on fasting and praying. Just so we understand, fasting and praying was not replaced when Christ died on the cross. It's a New Testament principle as well as an Old Testament. Fasting and praying. Jesus said to His disciples, not if you fast, but He said, when you fast, do such and such. He had compassion. He was moved by compassion for people. I asked myself as I studied through this text, am I moved by compassion for my neighbors who don't know Christ? Am I willing to sacrifice? Am I willing to put all on the line? Am I willing to be inconvenienced so somebody that I know might come to know Christ? Am I willing to put forth the effort as Nehemiah was willing? There's many, many wonderful people in this congregation, and I always want to be careful not to point out one or two, but I've got to tell you, Brother Tom is a constant encouragement to me because at the age of 79 and 6 months, he could have just retired a long time ago and sat back and said, I put in my dues, I've done my work, and yet if you know this brother, his attitude every morning is kind of like Caleb of old. Give me that land, give me that mountain, let's go do it, let's finish well. Compassion for people. Verse 5, what was Nehemiah's focus on? Better check my time here, I'll be in trouble. There you go. Nehemiah's focus was on God and on his word. We see that in verse 5. And I said, I pray, Lord God of heaven, O great and awesome God, you who keep your covenant and mercy with those who love you and observe your commandments. In times of difficulties, we need to pray, confess our sins. We need to focus on God and remember what God has said in his word. Verses 6 and 7, what two things does Nehemiah do? We read it. He cries out for God to listen. Lord, please hear me. Turn your eyes this way. You say, you mean God won't be looking if we don't ask him? No, it's a sincerity. It's a crying out. I asked to ask myself a question recently. When's the last time that I cried out to God in earnest for things that are needs around me, the needs of others, the needs of the community, to come to know Christ as their Savior? Some of you today, you're probably struggling with some family relationships. Maybe you have some kids that aren't walking with the Lord. Maybe you've got some marital struggles. My wife and I have been married 42 years. We've had our ups and downs, but God has been faithful to give us grace and mercy and kindness, and we enjoy each other more today than we ever have. I guess after a while, two become one, 42 years together. There are struggles with finances. There are struggles with health. Maybe God's speaking to your heart right now saying, you need to cry out to me. You've gone to the doctors. You've gotten the counsel. You've done all these things. You've changed jobs. Maybe you just need to come to me and say, God, show me how I can best please you. How can I glorify you? As I mentioned there as a summary, is that there's no hope of revival, spiritual life in our hearts without a love for God and for others. I think Jesus said something about that, right? Two great commandments? Pretty simple, right? Love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbor like you already love yourself. All of the rest of the commandments of God hinge upon those two, he says. Basically summarized. And then a genuine, committed prayer life. Not just prayer meeting at the church. By the way, I've noticed in my ministry life over the years as a pastor that in a lot of churches, the first service to go is prayer meeting. They just, people aren't interested. We're not going to do it. Who wants to just meet for prayer? I mean, you just want to get together for an hour and just break into small groups around the sanctuary and just pray and seek God's face? Yeah. Our last ministry, we had probably 25 to 35% of the Sunday morning group came back every Wednesday and met for prayer. I think it's one of the secrets of a healthy church is a church that's praying together. But it's more than just meeting for prayer. It's personal prayer, genuine prayer, seeking God and praising God. Prayer is not just asking, is it? It's also, Lord, can I thank you for today? Praying God, you know, Paul said, pray without what? Ceasing. Meaning throughout the day. Do you do that? Do you practice that as you walk hour by hour? Oh, Lord, thank you for that. And, oh, Lord, help me with this. And, Lord, my son needs to come to know you as a Savior. And thank you for my wife. Help me to understand her. Help her to understand me. God wants a relationship with us. And then, of course, repentance. A willingness to say, God, I've sinned against you. And Lord, show me my sins. Show me where I have some idols of my heart that you want me to start to tear down so I can really worship you completely. In verses 8 and 9, Nehemiah remembers the promises of God. He says, God, your word says that if we're unfaithful, you're going to scatter us. And you did that. And then he says, but you also said in your word, if you repent, if you obey, if you turn back to me, I will gather you together to that city of mine that has my name upon it. You know, I've learned one thing about God, and particularly from the life of Israel. Obedience brings blessings, and disobedience brings consequences. I don't always believe that, but when I believe it, it helps me. A couple of weeks ago, Lee was talking about the seriousness of sin and how a lot of times we will say, well, you know, I know it's not right, but it's okay. Disobedience always brings some kind of a consequence we don't want, some kind of a weed in the garden. But you say, where does the whole Christian life begin? Where does this Christian life start? It starts at the cross of Calvary. It starts by putting our faith in Christ. Let this piece of paper represent a record of all of our sins. Your sins and my sins, right? Now, honestly, there's not enough room in this paper to put all of my sins. But we'll just pretend. Maybe it's a 100 terabyte USB drive. Millions of pages. And let this hand represent you and I. The Bible says we have all sinned against the holy God. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Romans chapter 6. The Bible says that Jesus, let this hand represent Jesus. Jesus came, and what did he do? He took upon him our sins. This is you and I. This is Christ. This is our sin. We've all sinned against the holy God, and because of that, we deserve to be separated from God forever, because God will not tolerate any sin in his presence. But Christ came and he died on the cross and he paid for our sins and he was buried and he rose again and he forgives everyone who will put their faith, their trust in him so that we can have a relationship with God. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Now, some of you, this may be the very last time before eternity comes, whether you're young or old, you don't know what the future holds. This might be the last time you've heard that good news. And I implore you, I beg of you, listen carefully. God loves you, and he hates sin. He died on the cross to pay for our sins. He offers eternal life. He offers a relationship with him now and forever, and forgiveness if we'll put our trust in him, if we'll turn to Christ and say, Lord, you know I've sinned. I need you. Thank you for dying on the cross for all of my sins. Maybe that's why God brought you today. Maybe that was the message you needed to hear, a message of salvation. I'm mindful that our lives are but a vapor. A friend of mine who brought me to that Bible study many years ago, his name was Kurt Hare. He was 14 years old. He was riding his bicycle home one day after class, and he was killed by a car that hit him only two blocks from where we met for our Bible study. That was a traumatic reminder to me that I don't know the future, but I know the God who knows the future, and I know a God who loves me, and I could trust in him and put my confidence in him. Because God loves Israel, he had a personal relationship with them. Did you pick that up in verse 10? It was a personal relationship. Look at what the words say in verse 10. Now these are your servants and your people, whom you have redeemed by your great power and by your strong hand. If you just want a religious experience, then you can go to any church in this country, park yourself for an hour, kind of passively pay attention, and you can have a religious experience. But if you want to know the true and living God, the creator of all things, and by the way, there is no evidence to there's no evidence to support evolution, which is a theory. There's all kinds of evidence screaming out saying, look, there's a creator. Look at the design. Look at the order. Where did life itself come from? Do you really think that billions of years ago there was just nothing? And then there were rocks and ammonia and lightning that came from nothing. And then somehow the rocks collided and ammonia got in there and lightning hit it. And then poof, you were born. You say, that takes a lot of faith to believe that, friend. It does, because it's not true. The Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Evidence always points back to an intelligent design. In fact, many scientists today are not believing in evolution. They've moved on to a new theory called intelligent design. But when asked, they'll say, okay, if it's all from intelligent design, where did it come from? And they say, aliens. Aliens in a distant galaxy in a faraway place came to the Earth billions and billions of years ago and planted life, and then they left, and they've had no communication with us ever since. That's pretty unbelievable as well. God wants a relationship with us, not a religious experience. In verse 11, what does God ask of Nehemiah? What does God say? What does Nehemiah, I'm sorry, what does Nehemiah ask of God in this verse? Lord, I pray, please let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who desire to fear your name, and let your servant prosper this day, I pray, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. Nehemiah said, look, our desire is to know you and to serve you. Lord, please listen. Help us this day. Cut some things short here because we're running out of time, and I always like to end at a point that I still have your attention and what I'm saying means something to you. When I worked with teenagers, I told our youth staff, I said, after 20 minutes of teaching teenagers at a Friday night Bible study that have all been hyped up on Coca-Cola and pizza, you got 20 minutes. It's kind of like boring for oil. If you haven't reached oil in 20 minutes, quit boring. Well, I told our youth leaders, you get 20 minutes with teenagers. I find you get about 35 minutes, maybe 40 with adults. And I'm usually sitting out with you every week, so I understand the dynamics. But in chapter 2, verses 1 through 6, you can read this on your own. Nehemiah goes before the king, and the king says, why are you sad? Question, was it a good thing or a bad thing to go before the king with a sad face? Not a good thing. The king had a policy. You'll come into my presence with happiness or I'll have your head on a platter. I'm king, and nobody comes into my presence unhappy. And he came with a sadness, and he said, and the king responded and said, why are you so sad? You see, Nehemiah had courage after he had prayed and he had sought God and he reminded himself of what God's word said. He said, you know what? Somebody needs to stand in the gap. Somebody needs to go before the king and say, oh, king, this is why I'm sad. My city of my fathers, it lies in ruins. And so the king said, what can I do to help? And he said, can you give me letters of protection? Can you give me letters of supplies? And the king said, I will do that. Chapter 2. You see, my goal is not to give you everything, but to whet your appetite to go home today and tomorrow and read through the book of Nehemiah and see what a mighty God we really serve. Courage, walking in obedience to God and to his word for the purpose of glorifying God and doing so by his grace and by his mighty power that is working in and through us. Oh, if there's ever a time that American Christianity needs some courage, it's today. Men and women that will say, you know what? God is great. I'm going to stand in the gap with my God. I'm going to pray about it. I'm going to seek his word. I'm going to walk in obedience. I'm going to seek to bring him the glory and honor. But I'm not just going to stay in the bunker, a term that's been used a lot during this political season. It's time for believers to come out of the bunker. By the way, do not fall into that trap of name it, claim it. Name it, claim it. That's some religious teachers would say, well, if you just believe, God's going to have to give it to you. No, God always operates within the confinement of his revealed word of God. And so we can pray, Lord, if it's your will. But if something, if the word of God says that's wrong, don't ever pray for it. Because God's already said through his word, no, that's wrong. So we always pray, Lord, what does your word say and what is your will regarding the matter? Even Christ prayed that way, didn't he? In the garden, he said, Father, if you can take away this cup, this future death, this death of mine, so be it. But Father, not my will, but what? Your will be done. And so that's how we pray, trusting God with the outcome. Casting Crowns wrote a song a while back called Thrive. It's one of my favorites. I'm just going to play a short video clip of it. If you know it and you want to sing along, that's fine. But really listen to the words and think about how that our God is a mighty God who has prepared us for this hour, for this day, for this time to thrive, to be courageous, to trust him, to walk with him, and to see him do some great things.
Many a dream has died, like a tree planted by the water, we never will run dry. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to know you and to make you known. We lift your name on high. Shine like the sun, make darkness run and hide. We know we were made for so much more than ordinary life. It's time for us to more than just our Father's heart. Into the world we're reaching out to show them who you are. So living water flowing through, God, we thirst for more of you. Fill our hearts and flood our souls with one desire, just to
a great song. We were made to thrive. It's what God has created us for, to know him, to enjoy him forevermore, and to glorify him in the process. You can live a mediocre life where God is absent. You can live a mediocre life where you have religion, or maybe your parents or your in-laws or somebody says, oh, you ought to go to church. Or you can come to find the truth. Jesus Christ said in John 14, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Do you want to live in the bunker? Or do you want to live life to its fullest? Christ said in John 10, I've come to give you life and to give it to you what? More abundantly. Sometimes I think as believers, we've hunkered down and we've pulled back and, oh, the world doesn't like us and there's persecution and people don't want me telling them about Christ. So who cares? God cares. We can share our faith. We can live it out loud before those around us. We can reach out with a hand, reach to Christ with one, and reach out a hand to another. There's so much more in Nehemiah we're not going to get to today. But I do want to get to the conclusion of the matter. And the conclusion is found in Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 15. Just two verses, we'll wrap up. Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 15. 170 years, Jerusalem lay in ruins. 100 years, Jerusalem lay in ruins while the temple was being used for worship. 20 years, Jerusalem lay in ruins while Ezra was preaching the word every day and every week. And Nehemiah heard about it, and he was burdened. And he said, God, I can't do this, but God, I know what you want to do. Your word is clear. You want to restore Jerusalem. You want to restore the place where your name is lifted up. Nehemiah chapter 6, verse 15. So the wall was finished on the 25th day of Elul in 52 days. Does that not blow your mind? Can I get an amen on that? 52 days, 170 years had gone, over 100 years back in the land, never got the wall even started. In 52 days, God took a man that left the comfort of the palace to put his life with courage before the king where he might be killed, to say, God, I'm burdened, and Lord, your word says this, and we can trust your word, and we can trust in you and your great power and your great might. And God, I'm asking you to use me in some way, and if I'm going to die in the process, I'll die, but I'm going to at least try. Someone said a few weeks ago, I don't know if it's Tom or Lee or someone else, but, you know, we can either be a pew sitter or it can be a servant on fire for Christ. I hope you're one of those servants that just on fire. Let's do something for God in our homes, in our community, in our church. The wall was finished. The safety of Jerusalem was secured. And most of all, God was glorified and honored. Now, preaching of the word requires that we take 1 minute and ask ourselves these questions. What is it? Why did God bring you today? You say, well, he didn't bring me, I just came. Listen, if God did not give you the breath and the health and the ability and have you born in this place, you wouldn't be here today. Nothing comes into the life of the believer that's just happenstance. God either permits it or he purposes it, everything. Some things he permits, like with Job, right? With Job, Satan says, I want to test him, and God says, okay, I'll permit it. Paul the Apostle, God purposed it. God said, Paul said, God sent to me a thorn in the flesh, a physical ailment to keep me humble. Just want to take one or two comments. What do you see God trying to teach his church from this text today? Yeah, you can respond. What are you mulling over in your mind? I know you're not used to this, so if they ever ask me back ever again, get used to it. And then secondly, and maybe more importantly, is privately in your heart, what did God speak to your heart about today? Are you a humble servant who believes God's word, who understands the importance of prayer, praying with your wife, praying with your husband, praying as a family, praying as a church? You know, leadership must lead in the home. Leadership must lead in the church. And the best kind of leadership is servant leadership, as Christ was our example of a servant leader. He led, but with a servant's heart. Years ago, I was taught that you can never push leadership uphill. It must start at the top and flow down in the home, in the church, in the community, and in the country. May God help us as we continue to live for Him, to know Him more, and to seek to serve Him. But let's remember today that God accomplished something in 52 days. And in the next verse, which we did not read in Nehemiah 6, it says that, and the people knew, the whole area knew when it had been done, that God was behind it all. We call this place Spencerport Bible Church. Do you think our best days are behind us? Or do you think because of God and His promises and His Holy Spirit who lives within us, that if we will humble ourselves and confess our sin and really seek Him in prayer and fasting, that there wouldn't be enough room in this sanctuary to hold the congregation that God would start to bring in as unbelievers turn and repent and come to Christ? And then they'll need to be nurtured and taught to be reproducers. We live in exciting times, don't we? Not ordinary lives. We were born to thrive. Father, we just thank You for Your word. We thank You for Your Holy Spirit. We just, Lord, we need You. We love You. We don't always walk with You, but we ask You to help us this day to walk with You in earnest, to be Your servants, and to realize that though there are always going to be problems in the world, in our lives, our God is bigger, our God is greater, and we can trust You to give us the grace that is always sufficient and the wisdom. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.